simple terms, mm-hmm. trauma is a psychological wound mm-hmm. caused or brought about by a deeply painful experience.
Okay.
Now, this experience may be either primary or secondary, meaning mm-hmm. with primary, it may have happened to the individual himself or herself. Meaning maybe this person is hurt, maybe this person has lost a loved one, something like that. And in the secondary part of it, it means that this situation may have happened, this experience may have happened to someone else, but it is causing this individual a lot of distress. So that is secondary trauma, meaning this person is experiencing trauma, not necessarily what happened to him or her, but to another person, but it's causing this person okay. a lot of distress. Mm-hmm. So coming back to that question, how does trauma manifest? Mm-hmm. Trauma manifests slowly. Now, first of all, when an incident, a traumatic incident happens, or a painful experience, someone has experienced something that is so painful, that is so hurting, mm-hmm. normally what happens is what we call acute stress.
Okay.
So when during this level of acute stress, it means that this individual is going through a lot of anxiety, but has not reached that point where we say has stopped functioning. Mm-hmm. And if this person has stopped functioning, then it is just temporary,
okay.
not you know long term. So this is where now it starts. Mm-hmm. Now what normally happens is that when an incident or a painful experience happens to an individual, then the first thing that we do is basically to do what we call debriefing, mm-hmm. what we call critical incident stress debriefing. Mm-hmm. So that is something that needs to be done within the first 8 hours mm-hmm. of that particular incident. So we are saying at least within the first 8 hours, if possible, then people should be debriefed. Mm-hmm. Now this is now basically to avoid what will happen later if an individual does not have really the inner resources to deal with what's happened, mm-hmm. because not every individual goes through trauma. Some yeah. people have a way of coping with the situation mm-hmm. and they can manage on their own,
okay.
but some do go through that. Mm-hmm.
Okay, now you've talked about 8 hours, like the debriefing that has to be done 8 hours after the incident has happened. We know counseling is an entire process. Talking to a therapist, talking to a counselor is an entire process. So how soon or when should a survivor probably of somebody, whether terror attack, whether violence or anything, when should they seek counseling?
Okay, thank you, Patricia. Now, when you're talking about debriefing, it means that we are trying, it's like first aid. Actually, what we call it in counseling, we say critical incident debriefing is basically first aid. Mm-hmm. Now, when we give first aid, you are expecting that this person later on mm-hmm. will go to seek, you know, medical services. Now, mm-hmm. in this case, it's counseling services. Mm-hmm. But again, we do not forget the medical services themselves, mm-hmm. meaning as we do debriefing, this individual may also need medical services or medical intervention.
Yeah.
Now, that is the time we release, after now critical incident debriefing, we release this person to go seek medical help,
mm-hmm.
but this individual will come back again mm-hmm. to the counselor now to start the therapy session, depending on how this person has reacted to that kind of incident.
Mm-hmm.
Now, 8 hours, it means that is the shortest period we're actually, you know, banking on, but it can be 10 hours, you know, 15 hours, but you are saying the earlier the better, because the more we wait, the mm-hmm. more now this individual progresses to post-traumatic stress disorder.
Okay.
Now, after that, after this critical incident debriefing, then we say that if there are no physical injuries and this person seems not to be able to cope with the situation, now we can bring them for counseling. Now, this may take place, you know, within maybe, for example, the first 3 days,
mm-hmm.
1 month, okay. 1 week. It depends on so many things.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, if this somebody, for example, has lost a loved one,
mm-hmm.
we do not expect to start any counseling sessions before, for example, this person has been laid to rest,
yes.
or that significant other,
mm-hmm.
or a friend or a colleague.
Mm-hmm.
We have to wait until this person, for example, has reached a point where there are no other you know situations that are attached to this individual,
mm-hmm.
where they need or something that needs to be done on this other side, like maybe burial,
mm-hmm.
or maybe mourning the other person. Now we can bring them in. Now, after all this has happened, then you can bring them in and start counseling. But remember, we are doing this psychotherapy only when we get to realize that this individual has not been able to cope
mm-hmm.
with what has happened.
Okay.
Yes.
So now there are people who have different coping mechanisms. There are people who will prefer to just shut people out. There are people who just believe in themselves and tell themselves that I can do this. So speaking about a person who is, it is their first time to face something and they've been traumatized. And this is a person who has been used to dealing with things by themselves. They're not open to people. They don't believe in sharing their feelings or their experiences. How do we get to convince these people to come and to feel free and see the need to talk to someone? Because you find that certain people, they get as maybe as time goes by, this thing is still in them. They're traumatized, but they are in denial. They don't want to accept that this has happened and they need help. And this affects them later, and people fall into depression or something. So how do we deal with such people?
Okay, now, dealing with these people may not be so easy, because first of all, we have this belief that with everything that happens, especially anything to do with pain or something like that, you have to see a doctor. Mm-hmm. So we say that a doctor has a role to play, mm-hmm. a psychotherapist has a role to play. Mm-hmm. So we encourage these people that after they've gone, for example, seen the doctor, they've gotten, for example, if they were injured or they've gone through physical injuries, they've mm-hmm. got medication and it's not working, mm-hmm. then they should not just keep quiet there, okay. and say, I'll just deal with this alone, because it's not easy. And the thought that they may deal with it, you know, on their own, may seem actually something that is workable. Mm-hmm. But with the time, then they'll start now developing these other, now we call, other symptoms that may actually tell us who are standing on the side that this is not normal. Mm-hmm. And some of these things may include, for example, insomnia or hypersomnia, where mm-hmm. either they sleep a lot or they don't sleep. Mm-hmm. Either sometimes they become hyperactive and hyperreactive when they, for example, hear just a bang, they're jumping, yeah. and mm-hmm. they're looking on this other side. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they try this avoidance where they not want to visit any place that reminds them mm-hmm. of that particular incident that happened. But for them, they may not actually know that this is really something that is manifesting to something bigger than what they went through. So it's that person that is standing on the side who's able to tell. And that is why we say it's very, very important for even the significant others, the family members, the friends, to be able to be there for this individual, to be able to notice this gritty nitty, mm-hmm. the signs that we are seeing that okay. the individual themselves may not be able to see, because especially dealing with introverts, it's very difficult.
Yeah, it's very tough. It's very difficult. Because it's a person who believes because in their own space.
Exactly. It's like, I can do this on my own. I don't need people. Mm-hmm. But later on, they will need these people. So we say, yes, it may be difficult, but we need to sit with them, get to them. Anytime we discover that there is this behavior that is out of the norm, mm-hmm. then we'll talk to them. Mm-hmm. We talk to them and tell them, you know, this is not you. Okay. You haven't been like this before this incident. Mm-hmm. So kindly seek help. You've gone to the doctor, maybe you've gotten this help, but now you need to talk about this. You need to bring it out. Mm-hmm. So that way we are helping them, because on their own, they may not be able to make it. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. Probably now for a family out there who probably lost a loved one, or a person who was affected was there during the attack and everything, and they do not want to go for counseling. So how can the family members now try to, what can they look out for to see that this person is not okay? It's time now we need to convince this person to go and seek help. What do we look out for? Because most people are out there, yes, we'll talk about their times, like it's after it has manifested, people start behaving different ways. But what exactly does a parent, does a friend, does a significant other look out for?
Okay, now we'll start, for example, with children. With children, when they are going through these traumatic experiences, now it is manifesting to PTSD, what we call post-traumatic stress disorder, mm-hmm. we may see things like what we call regression of behaviors,
yes.
where, for example, they stopped wetting their bed, but now you see this child wetting the bed. Then mm-hmm. you say, something is not right. Mm-hmm. Some of them may not be sucking, they've been sucking their fingers when they're young, and then they stop, but mm-hmm. now they go back to the same behavior. Mm-hmm. Then you see, this is not right. Mm-hmm. Then these children may be clinging to their parents all the time, mm-hmm. something that may be behavior that wasn't there before, mm-hmm. but now it's coming back. Mm-hmm. Then you say, this is for the young children, because that's the only way are able to identify these signs, because they are not able to talk, okay. to explain themselves. Okay. Now, when we go to teenagers, now you'll find that for them, they end up now having this, for example, developing some overt behaviors, mm-hmm. where it's like they want to take revenge on something that happened. They don't even know how to take revenge on whom, mm-hmm. but they still feel like, I need to revenge. Mm-hmm. So they start developing this very weird behavior. Some of them will go to substance abuse, yeah. just to, you know, do like a cover up for mm-hmm. what is going on, the pain that they are feeling inside. Because remember, we said this is a psychological wound. You yeah. cannot see it. Mm-hmm. So even explaining to someone that I'm going through 1, 2, 3 may be hard for them. Mm-hmm. So they have start now having these behaviors, maybe drug and substance abuse, mm-hmm. or, you know, start smoking, mm-hmm. or sometimes they will either, for example, I try to avoid some of the things that they used to enjoy most. Mm-hmm. So they say that they pulling a back. Sometimes maybe they used to go with friends out, but now you find this individual just, you know, locking themselves in the rooms. Then you say, this is not right. And this is a time to say, hey, my friend, here you need to do something. Mm-hmm. If it's a son, a daughter, you say, you know what? Something is not right with you. I know you from day one, mm-hmm. and you haven't been like this. Mm-hmm. You need help, and I'm here to help you.
Okay.
Now, for the grown-ups, again, we go to, for example, insomnia, what he said, mm-hmm. that people lack sleep. They can't sleep well. well. Some of them is hypersomnia, for where some of them will sleep a lot. Yeah. That is out of the norm, that they just feel like there's nothing else. Mm-hmm. And now when you see somebody sleeping a lot, they're actually sinking into depression. Mm-hmm. They become hopeless. They feel like they have that feeling of hopelessness and helplessness. They don't know what to do. They don't know what to say. Okay. Then you see something here is not right. Also avoidance, where they also try to avoid situations where they really used to enjoy most. Mm-hmm. Then you say something is not right and I need to help. Some of them will become like hypervigilant, hyperactive, yeah, you know, and hypersensitive, mm-hmm, where they see something or they hear something and they just want to duck, you know, and take cover because, mm-hmm, they feel like maybe this is something happening to me, yeah, again, mm-hmm, and all these things. So we say these are some of the signs that we really need to look at. Some of them will even have nightmares, especially for the children. Sometimes they really have nightmares, mm-hmm, because it just reminds me any other time they sleep and it's like, boom, they just wake up, sleep, scream, yeah, then you see something is not right. And this, okay, is the time we who are studying on the side get to know that this is not normal. Mm-hmm. And we also talk to these significant others. It's, mm-hmm, very important for them to understand what is happening to this individual. Because we cannot help this individual when even the significant other is not aware, yeah, mm-hmm, of what is happening, what trauma is, mm-hmm, what this person is going through. Because it may be a blame game, like, well, we're not sumboa. Yeah. You know, you're, yeah, causing a lot of this. Can you just stop this? Mm. Yet they do not understand that this person is sick. This is sickness, because if it progresses so much, it will become a mental issue.
Okay. So now, for example, now let's talk about parents or loved ones who now have to go. For example, during the Dusit D2 attack, we saw loved ones going to identify the bodies of their loved ones. It's a very painful experience. You've lost your child, but you have to get in there and identify them and see them in all that critical condition. So how do we get to deal with these individuals before and after they've gotten to identify the bodies of their loved ones?
Okay, thank you for that question, Patricia. And I'm happy about that question because I'm part of that, helping individuals, especially when they are at Chiromo. Mm-hmm. I've been there several times, mm-hmm, and we are there to take them through all this entire process. Mm-hmm. Now, before they go to identify their body, we need to do the debriefing,
okay,
meaning that we sit somewhere, and under so many situations, we meet, for example, at the hospital, you know, yard there, mm-hmm, and as they are coming in, we are there. The counselors are already there, mm-hmm, waiting to debrief them, mm-hmm, on what to expect. And then also we are also trying to assess their strengths, because there are some who will come, for example, a mother and a father, but, mm-hmm, a mother cannot stand, yeah, you know, the sight of a dead body. Mm-hmm. So we do not just say because it's your daughter you have to move in. No, we allow that person who is strong enough to be. So all there are some of these assessments you are doing before, mm-hmm, they go to view the body, mm-hmm, because before that we've already briefed, because they know that, for example, they've already lost, for example, a daughter or a son, mm-hmm, or whoever it is, a significant other. Mm-hmm. So as they come, they know that I'm coming to view the body, mm-hmm, but now they don't know the state at which the body, yeah, is. Mm-hmm. Or they've never even seen a dead body before. So it may sound easy as they're leaving their houses, but when they are there, some of them will even crash before they get in. Mm-hmm. So that debrief is to be able to assess, are they able to go and be able to see this body? If, mm-hmm, not, who among these who are here? Because most of them, it's not just an individual who, yeah, comes, you find, yeah, two, three, four family members. Mm-hmm. So we try to assess who is able to go and be able to stand the sight of that body. Mm-hmm. And sometimes these bodies have really been mutilated. Mm-hmm. Some of them are in bad shape. Some of them have been artificially reconstructed. Mm-hmm. And we let them aware of the situation before they go there. Mm-hmm. So here, it's not a matter of hiding, mm-hmm, and using these other, you know, sugar-coated terms like, unajua mwili ni mbaya, we have to say mbaya how?
Yeah.
Because,
yeah,
here is a matter of truth. So that even as they walk in, they will not be like they are in shock. Mm-hmm. Is this what I was really expecting? They should know prior to, you know, viewing that body, that this is what I'm really expecting.
Okay.
And again, after we viewing that body, we are there with them. Most of the time we encourage counselors, or most of the time we are there. We walk in with them, we help them, we hold them, we try to support them as they view the body, as they say that this is actually my daughter, what? We let them, we allow them to grieve, even, okay, as they are, we allow them to cry, mm-hmm, and then we take them out. Again, when we take them out, we would not want to talk to them so much because, mm-hmm, they're already in pain.
Yeah.
So what we do, we just have a sitting with them and try to inquire, are you okay? Mm-hmm. Will you be able now to, you know, withstand this, go through this, mm-hmm, and go through the other process that is coming up, which is the process of burial. So,
okay,
all these things through the entire process, mm-hmm, counselors are there to help them, you, okay, know, debriefing before, debriefing after, so that at least we help them able to cope with the situation, because at that point it's not so easy.
Okay. Now, as the show is coming to an end, let's talk about someone who has been through a double event, whereby, as I was looking through researching on my topic, there was a survivor. There's a lady who survived the Westgate attack, and unfortunately, she was at the. She also experienced the Dusit attack, but survived. And now, for such individuals who have experienced double events of trauma, how do we get to deal with these people? Because now I feel it gets to a point whereby a person now. Probably now the insecurities are more higher than the person who has only experienced just one event. So how do we get to deal with such individuals as we wind up?
Okay, thank you, Patricia. That's very true. That sometimes a recurring traumatic incident may actually cause a lot of trouble to this particular individual, because it's like for them, they may actually, sort of go to post-traumatic disorder very quickly, mm-hmm. compared to that person who has just experienced once. Mm-hmm. But again, remember, Patricia, what I said, that people have different inner resources to cope with situations. Yeah. You may find that somebody has gone through 2-3 different kind of such critical incidences, but yet they are able to withstand, mm-hmm. because they have the inner resources to deal with that. Okay. Maybe even the support they've been getting from the first incident was enough to take them through. Mm-hmm. So here again, we talk about support. Mm-hmm. It all depends on what support did they get during the first incident. Mm-hmm. That is family support, friend support, all this kind of support. Mm-hmm. And again, did they manage to deal with that before this one came up?
Okay.
Because where we have what we call unfinished business, that's where the situation becomes even worse. Mm-hmm. Meaning you are carrying a lot of baggage. You have that baggage and then another one has been put on top. Mm-hmm. That is where we say, mm-hmm. the only way we can help them is be able to bring them on board, mm-hmm. talk to them, get to see how they are processing this one, mm-hmm. and get to see as they process this, are they bringing the other one back?
Okay.
If they are bringing the other one forth, then we see there's unfinished business here, there's unfinished business, and that's why now we go through therapy sessions.
Okay.
We go through therapy sessions
as
to help
them. As a counseling psychologist, do you think that group discussions is something that can help people deal with trauma? Probably for a person who does not believe in seeing a counselor individually, do you think support groups is something that can help? And how do we do to motivate people to have support groups when such things happen?
Very true. That support group does really work, or group therapy, it does really work for these individuals.
Mm-hmm.
Because some people may feel like, is it just me who has been jinxed? Maybe I'm jinxed, that's why this is happening to me. You know,
mm-hmm.
the first time, the second time, the third time,
mm-hmm.
or something like that. Even if it's just once,
mm-hmm.
somebody may start, blaming themselves
mm-hmm.
for something that is not their fault.
Mm-hmm.
So for these people, sometimes they feel like, if I go out, talk to a counselor one-on-one, how will they think of me?
Mm-hmm.
But then when we bring them now for group therapy,
yeah.
and they get to hear what other people have to share, it gives them now that kind of motivation to talk about the situation freely and feel that, oh, it's not just me. It can happen to anyone. It's not my fault.
Mm-hmm.
It just happens. This is something just happens. It just doesn't have to be me. It's not because I was in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Mm-hmm.
It just happened. So even if it happens twice, sometimes people feel like, I was there and it happened, and now I'm here, it happened. Is it me?
Mm-hmm.
Is there something that I'm doing wrong and that's why it's happening?
Mm-hmm.
So with group therapy, it helps them to share their experiences,
mm-hmm.
get to know that it is something that can happen to anyone, get to share those experiences. Maybe they're also going through the same or even different situations, but the fact that we brought them together,
okay.
Maybe this is a fire incident. Maybe this is what happened, like now the terror attack.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe this is something. Now, when you bring them together, then we say, oh, this has really happened. It can happen to you. It has happened to this one. If they are talking, I can also talk. We can share it with you. How did you deal with it? How are you even dealing with it now? Because
okay.
they are able now to ask these others, how do you deal with this? How are you dealing with it right now?
Okay.
So that sharing enables them to even develop more sophisticated coping mechanisms to
okay.
deal with what they are.
Okay. Yes. Thank you very much, Zakia, for really joining us and sharing shedding light on that topic. All I can say is that for people who have been affected, probably it's a challenge that we should give to the society, the church, to organize events whereby people can go and talk, because as we've said, it's not easy to really go and talk to someone. So probably someone is going to be free in an open environment than behind closed doors. So that is all we have for you tonight on Y254 News. Thank you very much for staying with us. Coming up is Karaoke Live. Thank you very much. My name is Patricia Morioki. Do have yourselves a very good night.